Nariye Seyda Metova'yı Kırım Tatar dilinin toplumsal işlevi, tarihi ve çağdaş durumu başlıklı bildirisini sunmak üzere kürsüye davet ediyorum. Buyurun.
Sizin dikkatinize Kırım Tatar dilinin toplumsal işlevi konusunda bildirimizi nakıs verdim. Kırım Tatar dili çok asırlık gelenekleri olan Türk dillerinden birisi olup günümüzde korunması ve saklanıp kalması ihtiyacı vardı. Çünkü Kırım Tatar dili için toplumsal funksiyonların büyük miktarda zayıflaması kastı. Dillerimizde Kırım'da 19. yüzyılın sonu günümüzde kadar olan dil durumu tasvir edildi. Kırım Tatar dili kullanımının dinamikasını dil durumunun inkişafında esas eğilimleri belirtmek niyetli korunuyor. Çünkü bu meselelerin çözülmesini Kırım Tatar dili kullanımını tam şekilde tasvir etmeyi en de uygun bir dil siyasetini işlep çıkarmaya yardım edebilir. Kırım Yarımadası'nda uzak zamanlardan beri birçok diller kullanılır idi ve bu bölgede olup geçen etnik ve dil proseslerini tahlil etmeye sosyal lingvistika için hem nazari hem ameli kıymeti vardır. Bu küçük coğrafik bölgede şimdi de farklı dil ailelerine ait olan diller kullanılır. Onların birbirine karşılıklı tesiri, ilişkileri ne kadar devamlı olmalı. Mesela Kırım Tatar dilinde Yunan ve İtalyan substrat sözlerinin var olanı hem de ilişkiler nasıl tarihi şaraitlerde olup geçkenliğine, yani ehalisinin sayısı, yazı dil gelenekleri olanı ya da olmahanı, devletçiliğinin olanı ya da olmahanı ve başkaları de sıkı bağlıdır. Dinin toplumsal işlevi dediğinde onun belli bir bölgede yaşayışını çeşit türlü sahalarda temel ihtiyaçlarla ilgili faaliyeti, içtimai siyasi faaliyet, gündelik yaşayış, düzgün tahsil sistemasında, bedi edebiyatta, kütlevi komünikasyon, estetik tesir, halk ağız yaratıcılığı, ilim, iş yürütüf, şahsi yazışma, dini merasimler gibi sahalarda kullanılması göz önüne alınır. Şunu da kaydetmeliyiz ki bir devlet sınırlarında dillerin birbirine tesir etmesi ve onların fonksiyonel yüklenmesi sosyolingvistikada dil durumu anlamı ile bağlıdır. Dil durumu diakronik bir anlam olup, içtimai siyasi prosesler ile sıkı bağlı olan, sıkı alakalarda bulunan. Böylece Sabık Sovyetler Birliği'nde olan dil durumu için onun teritoriyasında olan dillerinin resmi olarak kesin bir statüsü olmadığını hastır. Kırım Tatar dilinin yazı edebi şekilleri orta asırlarda da olan ama onların özgün janrları ve üslubi hususiyetleri olandır. Günümüzde kadar resmi vesikalarının örnekleri, han yarlıkları, halkara yazışma ve iş kağıtlarının örnekleri, yani senetler, nizamnameler ve başkaları, divan edebiyatının eserleri saklanıp kalan. Eski Kırım Tatar dili o zamanın ortak Türk dili tesiri altında bulunuyordu. 18. yüzyılın sonuna kadar Kırım'da dil durumu tek dilli olarak karakterizlenebilir. 1783 yılı Kırım'ın Rusya tarafından zapt olunmasının Kırım Tatar halkının ve Kırım Tatar dilinin takdirinde yanı sayfı açıldı. Bu vakıptan başlap Rus dili Kırım'da daha da geniş yayla. 19. yüzyılın birinci yarısında Kırım Tatar ve Rus dillerinin kullanılığı etnik sınırlar içerisinden çıkmaydı. Kırım Tatar dili ise Kırım'da milli dil için has olan bütün sahalarda tam değerli dil olarak işletildi. 19. yılının sonunda sonuna kadar Kırım'da Rus dilinin kullanım sahaları genişledi. Kırım'ın Rusya terkibine kırması mevcut memuri hukuki sistemanın bozulmasına, Kırım'ın siyasi kurumunun ve kanunlarının yok edilmesine getirdi. Rusya'nın totalitar idaresi neticesinde Kırım'da diglosiya dil durumu şekillendi. Devlet ve iş yürütüf dili vazifelerini Rus dili eda ediyordu. Kırım Tatar dili ise tek ailede ve gündelik yaşayışta kullanılıyordu. Bu vaziyet Kırım Tatar ruhanilerinin, mırzalarının, ziyalılarının Romanya'ya ve Türkiye'ye hicret etkenleri sebebinden daha da ağırlaştı. Kırım Tatar dilinin funksiyonel alanı son derece darlaştı. 100 yıl devamında 1783-1883 yılları arasında hiçbir kitap, hiçbir dergi veya gazet neşir olunmadı. Rusya'nın siyaseti dil sahasında da aks olundu. Bu siyaset açıktan açık gayri demokratik ve milliyetçilik karakter taşıydı. Rus dilini başka dillerden üstün çıkarmak için yönetilgen idi. Bunun neticesinde Kırım Tatar dili sadece ailede, kundelik yaşayışta ve kısmen ihtisal sahalarında kullanıla başladı. Bir de bir periyodik meşirlerinin olmağını durumunu daha da zor yapa idi. 19. yüzyılın sonu 20. yüzyılın başında Kırım Tatar dilinin toplumsal funksiyaları biraz genişlene. Milli tahsil, bedi edebiyat, periyodik basın, Kırım kitap neşir olunması, tiyatro sanatının alanlarında Kırım Tatar dili daha çok kullanıla başlar. Sonra birkaç vakit devamında Kırım Tatar dili gayrıdan devlet ve yerli idare müesseselerinde, resmi iş yürütüde, ilimde, radyo yayınlarda kullanılıp başlar. 19. yüzyılın sonu, 20. yüzyılın başında kullanılan Kırım Tatar dilinin yazılı şekilleri bir soy değil edilir. Bazı metinlerinin dili Osmanlıca, Türkçe'ye yakın olsa, diğer metinler farklı şivelerde yazılgandır. Belli olanı ki bu, 20. yüzyılın 20. seneleri Kırım Tatar edebi dilinin orta yola şivesi esasında şekillendirmeye kararına gelingen idi. Edebi dilin inkişaf ettirmek için Arapça ve Farsça kelimelerden vazgeçmek ve Kırım'ın Kıpçak hem Oğuz lehçelerinden faydalanmak gözde tutula idi. Yanıdan canlanma devrim İsmail Gasprinski'nin 1883 senesinden çıkan Tercüman gazetesi ve şahsi matbaası ile bağlıdır. 1883'ten başlar, 19. asrının sonu ve 20. asrının başında yalnız gazete değil, Tercüman matbaasında yüzlerce kitaplar basılıp, şuların arasında tabii fenler boyunca soyları da çok idi. Matematika, geologiya, anatomiya, coğrafya, endese ve başkaları. Tercümanın özünde ve Alemi Nisvan, Alemi Subyan dergilerinde ve Tan Hadimi gazetinde çoktan çok makaleler basıldı. 19. asrının sonu ve 20. asrının başında onlarla tercümeli ve terminolojik lügatlar neşir olunan idi. Kimya, fizika, riyaziyat, biyolojiya ve başka fenlerle birçok ilmi edebiyat Rus dilinden Kırım Tatar diline çevrilip neşir olunan idi. Uyanuf devrinde Kırım Tatar dilinin dili kullanılığının genişlemesi 19. asrının sonunda caditizm hareketi meydana gelmesine bağlıdır. İsmail Gasprinski'nin faaliyeti de Kırım Tatar milli kimliğinin şekillenmesine çok tesir etti. Usul icedik mekteplerinin işinde hocalarının işine büyük dikkat ayrıla edildi. Cadidlerinin maksadı İslam cemiyeti tahsil cemiyetinin tahsil tahsil sistemasının ıslah olunması ile gençlerge bilgi verilmesi ile Avrupa ülkelerinin Uzbek tecrübesini önemsemesi ile modernleştirmek idi. Böylece birçok Kırım Tatar gençleri Türkiye'de okuhan edilir ve sonra Kırım'da hocalık faaliyetini devam etken edilir. 1917 senesi devriminden sonra Kırım'da 50 iptidai okuf yurdu ve köylerde balılar bahçeleri açılgan edi. Bundan da gayrı 6 yıllık Rujdiye mektepleri birçok Kırım şehirlerinde çalışıp başlagan edi. Ve elbette bu mekteplerinin açılması Kırım Tatar dilinin inkişafı için büyük tesiri olgan edi. Yani daha çok balalar mekteplerge katnap Kırım Tatar dilini öğrenmeye ve Kırım Tatar dilinde tahsil almağa çareleri olgan edi. Ocalarını hazırlamak için Kırım'da 4 yıllık ocalarını hazırlayıp kursları açılan idi. Ve bu hareketler 20. asırının 20-30. senelerde devam edilgen idi. Ve tahsil sistemasında, ilk evvela tahsil sistemasında pek çok işler yapılgan idi. Sovyetler zamanında siyaset, tahsil sahasındaki siyaset iki türlü idi. Ona tamırlaşu siyaseti de depaydalar. Ve Kırım Tatarları için daha çok mektepler açığa edilir. Böylece 1920 yılı devamında 500'den ziyade Kırım Tatar Mektebi çalışkanı görülüdü. Elbette bu mekteplerin çalışması için birçok derslikler, metodik kullanmalar, kitaplar gerekirdi. Ve bundan da gayrı ocalar gerekirdi. Mahsus ocalarını hazırlar teknikum teşkil olganıydı. Ve böylece bu okuf yurtlarında Abibullah Odabaş, Bekir Çobanzade, Osman Akçuraklı gibi belli Kırım Tatar edipleri ders deli edilir. 1924 yılı Kırım Tatar, Kırım'da çalışkan mekteplerden 38%'i Kırım Tatar mektepleri olganı bellirdi. Ve bu işler de devam ediliydi. Ve bu mektepler için yıl yıldan çıkarılan edebiyatının kitaplarının sayısı daha da çoklaşaydı. 1929-30 yılları devamında 900 basma tabaklı miktarında edebiyat, Kırım Tatar dilinde edebiyat neşir olunganı belirdi. Ve böylece bu senelerde 30. senelerine kadar Kırım'da tahsil sahasında ve kitap neşircilik sahasında bayağı çok işler yapılgan idi. Kırım Tatar dilinin kullanım sahalarını genişletmeye imkan açtı. Ve bundan da gayrı 1928 senesi yanı Türk Belediyesi'ne geçildi. Tahsil sistemasının için bir daha inkişafı için daha bir sistem oldu. Ve şimdi 1932-33 yıllarında 400'ye yakın başlangıç Kırım Tatar Mektebi ve 50'ye yakın Orta Kırım Tatar Mektebi olduğunu biz biliyoruz. Bundan da gayrı Kırım Tatar Dilinde Okutuf Pedagogika Üniversitesi'nde, Tibiyat Üniversitesi'nde, Ziraat Mekteplerinde ve başka sanayi mekteplerinde de geçiriliyordu. Milli medeniyetin mühim bir kısmı bedi yaratıcılığıydı. Ve Kırım'da bedi yaratıcılık sahasında 19. yılının sonundan başlayıp tiyatrının ilerlemesini gözde tutmak mümkündür. Sahnada hem Kırım Tatarca hem de tercüme eserler koyula edi. 1923 yılında ise mahsus Tatar Tiyatr Teknikumu açılganıydı ve şu Tatar Tiyatr Teknikumu'da aktör, rejissör, müzika, balet gibi bölümler olganını biliyoruz. Ama sonra 1930'cı seneleri Sovet hakimiyetinin siyaseti denişti ve sovetizasiya, rusifikasiya gibi prosesler daha da geniş yayıldı. Böylece 1938 yılında tahsilde Kırım Tatar dilinde okutulan mekteplerinin kapatılması kaydedildi. Bundan da gayrı birçok Kırım Tatar hocaları, ziyalıları hapske alınganıdır ve kurşun cezasına uğratılganıdır. Böylece millet hocalarsız ve mekteplersiz kaldı ve Kırım Tatar dilinin kullanılığı daha da zayıflaştı. Ve endi 1940 senelerine yakın, yani sürgünlükke yakın Kırım'da Kırım Tatarca tahsil bergen mektepler kalmadı desek mümkündür. Sürgünlükten sonra ise 20. asırın 100 yılının ikinci yarısında Kırım Tatar dilinde nispeten diskriminasyon siyaset neticesinde Kırım Tatar dilinin toplumsal funksiyaları mahsus tapaştırılan edi. Kırım Tatar dilinin sosyal ve çerki kurumu bozulgan edi. Kırım Tatar dili Sovetler Birliği halklarının dilleri cedvelinden alıp taşlangan edi. Onun ilmi cihetten öğrenilmesi yasak edilgen edi. Ve Kırım Tatar dili tek edebiyat, bedi edebiyat sahasında öz yerini belli bir derecede saklap kaldı. Kırım Tatar dilinin toplumsal kullanımının tarlaşkanın sebebinden en mühimi Kırım Tatar dilinde tahsil sistemasının bozulmasıdır ve bunu arkadaşım da açıklayacak. Ve en evvela mekteplerini, Kırım Tatar dilinde okutkan mekteplerinin sayısını arttırmak gerektir. Neticede Kırım Tatar dili idari teşkilatlarında, ilim ve terminoloji sahasında kullanılmaya başladı. Ve böylece şimdiki durumunda Kenya'da Kırım Tatar dilinin funksiyaları, toplumsal funksiyaları pek az kalmaktadır, pek zayıf olarak kalmaktadır. Ve şimdi Kırım Tatar dilinin öyle basında ve tele ve radyo yayınlarda kullanılması artırıla ama hep bir Kırım Tatar dili daha çok aile içinde konuşma dili olarak kullanılmaktadır. Onun vaziyetini kurtarmak yollarından elbette Kırım Tatar dilinin her bir sahada kullanılması gerektir. Dikkatiniz için teşekkür ediyorum.
Yardımcı doçent doktor Nariye Seyda Metova'ya teşekkür ederiz bildirisi için. Şimdi ikinci bildiri. Ukrayna'dan Oksana Tishenko Monastyrska, Code Switching in Crimean Tatar.
Several mechanisms of language attrition are often described. And in code switching, change in code switching patterns is one of them. In my study, I'm trying to learn mechanism of structural borrowing in language contact situation that have Crimean Tatar and Russian bilingual speech, namely code switching with morphemes and lexical structure from both of the languages in contact. My study was conducted in Crimean Tatar speaking villages and Serb places. And when looked at the cultural life, it seemed that mother tongue is still widely used within the family, when the dominating language in Crimea is Russian. And this leads to code switching phenomenon that leads to language shift or maintenance in the bilingual or multilingual environment. As code switching is frequently observed in their communication environment as a result of language contact. And here are some official data. Applying the theory of code switching and code mixing to the languages of Ukraine, we should recognize an interesting fact that Ukrainian-Russian bilingualism is a widespread condition of language ecology in many regions of Ukraine, and Crimea is among them. So Crimean Tatar community is embedded in a priori bilingual situation. The aim of this paper is to describe code switching between Crimean Tatar and Russian based on the speech samples gathered from suburban and village bilingual settings and analyze them using Myers-Cotton's model, which consists of two aspects, structurally based matrix language frame and socially based considerations in code switching. Data for the study were collected from the villages and the cities where bilingual Crimean Tatars resided. All interviewees were native speakers of Crimean Tatar, additionally 3 hours tape recorded natural conversations were gathered during informal visits and wedding ceremonies. And I also used videotape conversations used in news broadcast in the ATR TV channel, the Crimean Tatar media resource. Also, some linguists use the terms code mixing and code switching interchangeably. I'm following the distinctions laid out by Oersten and Blumkulpa. Code switching is when the speaker alternates units from different codes that are higher level constituents, at least grammatical clauses or sentences, while code mixing refers to smaller units, usually words or idiomatic expressions, which are borrowed from one language and inserted into the sentence of another language. In Crimean Tatar spontaneous speech, these both are represented. The unconsciously code-mixed Russian words found in the speech and writing of the Crimean Tatars described here belong to a variety of grammatical classes, including particles, adverbs, conjunctions, and question words, but can be grouped into the single functional class of discourse pragmatic words. The Russian words code-mixed in Crimean Tatar preferred speech include, but not limited to, discourse markers. And Brinton puts forth a different list of features, which you can see in this slide. Using all of these characteristic features as diagnostic criteria, following items of the code mixed Russian words found in Crimean Tatar preferred speech would be interpreted as prototypical discourse markers. However, the set of Russian discourse pragmatic words code mixed in Crimean Tatar preferred style is significantly larger. They are not all discourse markers. even though they are all linguistically encode pragmatic functionality, which is topic change markers, contrasting markers, elaboration markers, inferential markers. But here I, in my material, I found coordinative, evaluative, and subordinative markers. And for example, coordinative discourse markers, conjunctions E and A, no, no, to, and many others. For example, kittuk I yolda ekikiri cemezi vardı. All next sentence where duplicated conjunction is used. On se nadenzere, to zelenakovskaya baredek, to uchikozunjemi baredek. All code mixed Russian coordinators are used as markers of narrative structure and coordinate idea units, rather than acting as logical operation operators coordinating items in the list. Next category is evaluative discourse markers. For example, the adverb prosto simply just is used as a minimizing hedge in Russian, one that shows that the preposition doesn't contain any kind of additional augmentation imposed on it by the situation or context. And the example is не допайтаем ссылки, берегим шинды джушты просто. Also, evaluation of time represented by Russian word уже already. In the case ноябрь айында уже қар яуған еді. And the evaluation of degree in the sentence. In the case қысмет олса, фундаментіні уже бұтырдығы бойы. Вот. Also, subordinating discourse markers are used, and for example, discourse marker что that обергенты что не суд полочек. Кроме татар using a code mixed что that is almost identical syntactically to Russian. Tatar is essentially a calque of the Russian with a subordinate clause that comes after the main clause, and it's introduced by a subordinating conjunction. And next category, these are metacommentary words. Короче, кстати, в общем, represented by the example парама стоит медже, кушама сдали. Летничек, Гвалара и Тувар, ну, в общем, Чарим из Йох, я думаю, это не делаю. This, короче, in brief, points out that the speaker is summarizing and marks equative or positive structure such that the content preceding it must approximately conform to the content following it. And in this part, I would like to pay your attention to functional aspects of code switching when larger units clauses being code switched. As first example, I choose one interesting case where Russian preferred Crimean Tatar man shows what is the language he used speaking with his son. And Russian Crimean Tatar code switching can be often used when the speaker is reporting what someone has said. And from this comment, we can see that the man is initially referring to his son's words, first in Russian, and then in Crimean Tatar. The answer in Crimean Tatar may reflect the serious nature of it, and here code switching is weak code. It's informal and intimate. Next example of code switching. Here, до другого педики, бубером, праздник сповнений сльоз, глазами эбобедного. The interviewee is not only answering the question, but also animating the voice, as Russian words sound stricter and more official than the Crimean Tatar beginning of the sentence. The speaker's tone rises, and the entire Russian phrase is pronounced very clearly and smoothly. An explanation for code switching here is that the interviewee repeats the words of a well-known quote. Another reason could be a matter of expressivity. Next examples. As for the language choice patterns found, speaker stick to his individually preferred language in the specific setting. Only when the degree of topic involvement rises in the conversation, Crimean Tatar Russian code switching is used to differentiate the topics of the talk. And here, in these examples, the Russian language seems to be associated with official situations, and Crimean Tatar is more intimate and close. And in this sentence presents so-called language of emotions. I took it from a student's conversation, and the student is animating the teacher voice. An explanation for code switching here is that the student repeats the words of the instructor and wants to be more authoritative. Another reason could be a matter of expressivity. He was nervous that the code student hadn't listened properly and was asking to repeat. And the last my slide is about switching on a morpheme level. First category is often happens in Crimean Tatar proper names, where the second category is more widespread. And as conclusion of my talk, I would say that one word, one phrase, or even one sentence code switching is very common in Crimean Tatar speech. This kind of code switch helps to bridge a gap in the discourse and plays a role of compensatory strategy. The results show that during conversation, people use Crimean Tatar as the language they feel most comfortable with and have greater competence in. In the informal situation, Russian as the second language can fulfill a wide range of functions, from changing topic, facilitating conversation, to showing expressivity. Thank you very much.
Oksana Hanım'a kod kaymasıyla ilgili bu değerli bilgisi için teşekkür ederiz. Üçüncü bildiri İspanya'dan Dr. Miguel Cabal Guaro. Linguistic vitality, uses and attitudes amongst the Crimean Tatar youngsters.
Well, I would like to be honest with all our colleagues and with the organizing committee. I would like to say that I am not a doctor yet. I am writing my dissertation. So I was very glad to receive a PhD degree just for arriving into Ankara, but it's too bad that I am still, I'm not a doctor yet. So I'm going to present my project of a dissertation. It is going to be about, well, that's what the title says, Linguistic Vitality, Uses and Attitudes amongst the Crimean Tatar youngsters. And it is my personal project. I received a very small private funding for it, but it is my personal enterprise, so I'm very excited to present it here. Let's have a small summary of my presentation. I'll make a short introduction. I will present you, it is a case study, so I will present you the questionnaire, the main facts of the field research. And then I will give you only two keywords of the theoretical framework, not to insist very much on this issue. And then we'll see how can we analyze the degree of endangerment of the Crimean Tatar through the figures which come from my study. And then we'll try to get some conclusions out of that. So as I have already said, this article takes part of the works from my dissertation, Linguistic Vitality, Uses and Attitudes Amongst the Crimean Tatars. I took a sociolinguistic survey. The total amount of interviewees, it's 581 Crimean Tatars, just 1 year ago. It was mainly 8th, 9th, and 10th grade students in 10 out of the 15 Crimean Tatar schools, and also some students of the Crimean Engineering and Pedagogical University, that amounts to 370. And also 211 adult Crimean Tatars. The questionnaire I used was based in a questionnaire which is in use now for a longitudinal project of the University of Barcelona, based on this questionnaire called Race Socialization and Languages. It is a longitudinal project, as I have already said. It is working for 5 years now. So the questionnaire takes sociodemographic and sociolinguistic data of the respondent and his or her relatives, about language competence, as well as about linguistic attitudes and representations. The questionnaire was always offered in Russian and Crimean Tatar, so the respondent had this choice to make. And the questionnaire itself was reviewed by a noteworthy number of local scholars, local I mean Crimean, to guarantee the correct adaptation. Amongst them, I can name Dr. Naria Sidametova, Dr. Yeniseya Biblaeva, and Oksana Tyshenko-Monastirska, who also accompanied me along this tour through the Crimean Tatar schools. The sample taken was, we preferred the older students, so from 14 to 22 years, from 8th grade to 3rd, 4th course in degree university, because it looked to us, they appeared to us the most suitable focus of study for this kind of questionnaire. Schools were selected for practical reasons, basically. I was in Crimea for a month and a half only, so I had to organize my tiny schedule somehow. They had to accomplish two conditions. The first of them, they had to offer all grades of general education from 1st to 11th, from 1st to 11th grade. And they had to be willing to receive us, because there were two schools who said that they were not willing to do this survey. So 10 out of 15 schools, as has been said, they were survived. This paper will speak only about a small number. This is a pre-study. This is a pilot study of my dissertation study. So I have used only the ethnic Crimean Tatars of the Simferopol school and also of the university. So it makes a total of 85. It is a tiny sample, I know. But nevertheless, the results have proved to be very significant through the statistical tests. So I'm showing them to you. The average age, yes, of the respondents is 17 and a quarter years. So they're pretty young. This is the same for adult school number 42. It is not legally, or I would say that it's legally, but it is not a Crimean Tatar national school, but it functions as it was. So almost all these students are Crimean Tatars, and the director and all the teaching staff are Crimean Tatars. And it is a huge school. As you see, it is 478 students. It's a pretty big school. And we surveyed 52 students, which made 54% of the 9th and 10th graders. So you can see this is the facade of the school. Then you can see here at the top, at the bottom right photograph, there's a girl speaking by his cell phone. It was very funny to see that when the surveyed students didn't know any of the answers, they called home and said, Mama, what year did we return? Did the family return to Crimea? Or Papa, what language did you speak at home when you were a kid? So, some keywords of the theoretical framework. We're speaking of linguistic vitality or ethno-linguistic vitality. For some authors, it's either ethno or not ethno. So it is, as stated by Gilles Borges and Taylor, that which makes a group likely to behave as a distinctive and collective entity within the intergroup setting. So, and then there's a revision 30 years after that, that says that although the actions of individual group members are influenced by reality, the perception of that reality is often, to a large extent, created discursively. I'm afraid this plays severely to the Crimean Tatar case. And I will also make a clear distinction between what is called rodnoy yazyk in Russian and mother tongue, and the classical concept of mother tongue in English. So for me, as a Catalan speaker, my mother tongue is Catalan because it's the language of my mother, and it's the language my mother spoke to me when I was a kid. But rodnoy yazyk for the Soviet-inherited scientific or social population is the language of the kin, the language of their ancestors. And as Dominique Arel says, by declaring a language their mother tongue, people often express their support for its use in society and promotion by the state, and that's the important thing, even if they do not back this preference by their own language practice. That's important, because in the data shown by Oksana, for example, 93% of the Crimean Tatars claimed that their rodnoy yazyk was Crimean Tatar. But that means that they identify themselves with Crimean Tatar. It doesn't mean that they have learned at home when they were kids Crimean Tatar. So we have taken as the L1, the initial language, the mother tongue of the respondents, the language stated as the answer to the question, which language did you speak at home when you were a kid? That was the question. While we interpreted the rodnoy yazyk as the language of identification of the respondents. All these questions will help us analyze the degree of endangerment of the Crimean Tatar language in three aspects. The first of them, it's intergenerational transmission, because we ask for the initial language of parents, the most frequent language with parents currently. The first language of children and the most frequent language of children currently, both at home and with their friends. And we also can see the changes in the fields of language use, and we also ask for the linguistic aptitudes regarding not only Crimean Tatar but also Russian and Ukrainian, of course. So I will show you now some significant figures, at least for me. I hope we can take any profit of them. So, this is the declared initial language of the, I repeat, this is not the rodnoy yazyk, this is the language they spoke at home when the respondents were kids. So we see that the vast majority spoke mostly Crimean Tatar and sometimes Russian. And there's a 32%, which is a big amount of respondents, claiming only Crimean Tatar to be spoken at home. And but the fact is the combination of Crimean Tatar and Russian takes 66%. So it's two-thirds of the respondents said that they spoke both Crimean Tatar and Russian in more or less in a more or less balanced situation at home when they were kids. So this is the declared initial language by gender. It is surprisingly significant. As you can see, the boys tend to say that you never know if they say it, if it's true, or if it is only what they can recall or they want to remind, you don't know. But okay, they claim that when they were kids, they spoke mostly Crimean Tatar and sometimes Russian, or Crimean Tatar and Russian equally, while girls, in a great amount, more than 40%, claim that they spoke only Crimean Tatar at home. We can see here by gender. I have separated here the results by the school respondent and the university respondent. So you can see that boys at school, there was not a single one who responded that they spoke Crimean, only Crimean Tatar at home when they were kids. Well, there was a 32% of girls responding there. It's a very significant difference. In university, nevertheless, boys say that in a 66.7% that they spoke only Crimean Tatar at home. So this difference makes me think that it is more a question of, I don't know how to say it, it's a question of will. Yeah, I would like that when I was a kid I would have spoken only Crimean Tatar at home, I don't know, something like that. So when they grow more linguistically conscious, they started claiming that they spoke only Crimean Tatar. So this is the language used with parents. As you can see, the vast majority uses a combination of Russian and Crimean Tatar as well. Only 16% uses only Crimean Tatar. And this is the difference between the languages with parents and the stated initial language. As you can see in the first, in the left, the only Crimean Tatar drops from a 32% to a 16% of average, so it's the half, exactly the half. We have separated also the use with father and with mother, by boys and girls, and it is different also. So boys tend to speak more Russian with mother and with father, whilst girls tend to speak more Crimean Tatar, especially with father. So it is pretty significant also. Right? Here we have a very significant table, the language with brothers and sisters by gender. There is not a single boy saying that he speaks only or mostly Crimean Tatar with his brothers or sisters. Well, there's a quarter of the girls claiming that they do that with their brothers and sisters. So, boys seem to speak widely more Russian at home with parents and with brothers and sisters. I'll skip that, it's too much. This is what we call the social network. It's got nothing to do with the internet social network, it's the human social network. It's the 10 people we asked to respond, the 10 people with whom I speak the most. And we got this result. So in a 44%, they said that only or mostly spoke Russian with the 10 people, or a combination of Russian and Crimean Tatar in 42%. So only mostly Crimean Tatar was used in social network only by 13% of the respondents. And again, we can see a big difference between girls and boys. We have here the same data, but separated by gender. And you can see that boys in a 76% say that they speak only or mostly Russian in the social network. This is the distribution of the typological distribution of the social network. So we can see that the respondents stated almost 72.5% of friends and only 26% of relatives. So the social network, we have to understand that mainly friends, mainly non-relatives. Although we have also grandparents, uncles, aunts, and brothers and sisters. And this is the language used by the social network typology. As you can see, the blue is Crimean Tatar in this graphic. As you can see, it grows as we approach the elder relatives. So we start with a 4.7 of only or mostly Crimean Tatar with friends, and it grows till a 94.7 with grandparents. So the respondents claim that they speak only or mostly Crimean Tatar, as you can see here, mainly with grandparents, uncles and or aunts, or also parents. And on the other hand, you can see that they speak only or mostly Russian in a 52.6% with friends, and equally in a 72% with cousins. So it is balancing from only or mostly Russian or equally in Russian and Crimean Tatar in all these cases. But only or mostly in Crimean Tatar, you can see the growth is very visually clear. We skip now to the linguistic attitudes. We surveyed like 10 questions per language, 10 regarding Crimean Tatar, 10 regarding Russian, and 10 Ukrainian. And this is the average punctuation. I have to say that the scale was from a minus 10 to a plus 10. So